Hello everyone, I am Michael Pinol, and I'm an engineer at Unity on the robotics team. In this session, I'll be covering simulation and simulating robots with ROS and Unity. So let's get started. For the agenda, I have the role of simulation in robotics, Unity and how it's used for robotic simulation, the robot operating system, ROS, bringing ROS and Unity together. We have a few short demo videos, and finally, resources and conclusion. Here we have an example of an early robot and its testing site. Notice the size of the area required for testing and also the size and configuration of the objects in the environment. It looks like this environment was meant to be set up and torn down when needed, which could potentially be a lot of work. This robot used hard-coded algorithms, so you could imagine a workflow that would have been something like, in a lab, develop your code, deploy it to the robot, and then have the need to test it in real life. So you load up all of these objects, you load up the robot, and you go to the testing site. You run the robot, you make your notes, make observations, and then you pack everything up and head back to the lab. Then you make changes to the code and then redeploy and try again until you achieve your desired performance. This sounds extremely time consuming and tedious for testing a robot with such a relatively simple task. Today, faster advances in artificial intelligence, things like computer vision and dynamic path planning, they help robots see, learn, and move through the world autonomously. As the complexity of robotic tasks grow, the number of tests and validations required to ensure performance increases at a much greater rate. This leads to a very big issue. Robots are expensive. Building a robot is expensive. Paying someone to work hands-on with a robot is even more expensive. Finding space available for and setting up test environments is potentially expensive and time-consuming. Luckily, simulation alleviates many of these issues. You can iterate much quicker on not only things like algorithm design, but you could also have an impact on the design decisions of the robot itself. Another big plus is that it allows for testing over a large number of varied environments. So to tie it up, why simulate? It is much quicker and easier to prototype and iterate in simulation than it is in real life. What does testing with a simulation look like? Well, first we need to define the robot's task. What is the robot supposed to do? Then we need to develop a method, algorithm, or approach for how the robot will solve that task. Then we can write code that will implement that approach. And instead of deploying to a real robot and testing in a real world environment, we're going to deploy to a simulated robot in a simulated environment. There, we can evaluate the results from the simulation. Did it work well? No, we can update our code and try again very easily, until we finally get to an acceptable performance mark where we warrant a real world test. So we can deploy to the real robot and evaluate in a real world scenario. If that test went well, we can go ahead and deploy to production. Thinking back to the robotic cart example earlier, I'm sure this type of workflow would have drastically reduced the number of trips made to the testing site. So thinking about to the simulation workflow, it really boils down to three main components. We need a robot operating in an environment with some sort of controlling code that's going to be run on the robot itself. So how does Unity fit into this? Well, Unity does these first two items really, really well. And the only thing that Unity's lacked thus far is the software that will be run on the robot itself. But first, why use Unity? Unity has an editor with a lot of features. Unity has a lot of services with more being added, specifically geared towards robotics and perception. There's high definition graphics and rendering, so your simulations can look as realistic as possible. And finally, it does not hurt that there's a vast amount of learning resources available for Unity. So here we have two examples by a company called Cross Compass, and they are using Unity to train a pick and place model. And it is first doing object detection and then pose estimation on objects in a bin and placing them on a conveyor belt. And if you look at the video on the right, you'll see that that same model is being run with domain randomization. So behind the glass there, you can see that the environment behind it is changing. And so this is to make the trained model just more robust. Another example is Forma.io, who used Unity to build a fleet simulator. So what this fleet simulator does is it models a warehouse, and you are able to track in real time the location of your fleet, so individual robots operating in that warehouse. So finally, we get to ROS. The best part about ROS is that ROS solves this third box issue that Unity was missing out on before. So what is ROS? Despite its name, it is not an operating system and it is more of a toolkit. It is a collection of shareable and reusable tools, libraries, and conventions that aim to make creating and managing robots easier. This is great because it allows you to reuse code for any configuration of hardware and software. ROS can be used to develop arms, sleds, drones, and even cars. There's a large community of developers sharing open source project, and that means that you can often pull code from other projects into your project and save time and energy. It can also be used to model sensors, actuators, and motors, as well as computer vision and path planning and other ML-enabled functions. And it's lightweight enough to be run on a single board computer, like a Raspberry Pi, but it can also be scaled up to be run on much more powerful computers. Just a quick overview. ROS is basically a collection of nodes, each dedicated to a single process or function, and communication between those nodes is done by queues, which they are referred to as topics. So how does it work? Messages are passed between nodes through topics. A node can subscribe to a topic to read messages or publish to a topic to write messages. The top of the slide shows a simple example of how data might flow between nodes and impact robot behavior, going from a wheel odometer reading to a path planner and finally to a motor controller. There is one master node that is helping facilitate node discovery and communication between nodes. So how does Unity fit together with ROS now? Unity handles the first two items of the components, so the robot and the environment, and ROS can handle the controlling code for the robot. So these are the three things that we are having required for a robotic simulation. So what does integration look like for Unity? So there's a single line of code used to publish or call a ROS service in Unity, and subscribing is as simple as extending a class. Here's a look at the architecture. It's a simple architecture diagram showing just an example of how this integration works. So to enable communication between Unity and ROS, we have made a TCP endpoint, which runs as a ROS node in the ROS network and handles all message passing between Unity and ROS. On the Unity side, we have made a TCP connector plugin, which provides the necessary scripts to publish, subscribe, or call a service using that TCP endpoint ROS node. One of the things to point out here is that this makes this more performant than other solutions is that the ROS messages being passed between Unity and ROS are expected to be serialized exactly as ROS serializes them internally. This is achieved with the message generation plugin, which generates C# classes, including serialization and deserialization functions from ROS messages. How is it set up? So first you need to import the plugins into your Unity project. Then you can generate the C# classes from ROS message files. And if you are looking to publish a message from Unity to ROS, you create an instance of one of those messages that was generated before, and then you call the TCP connector class with a .publish function call and send it on its way. If you're subscribing, it's only a little bit more work. So you need to extend the ROS subscriber class in a script, and then you need to override the asynchronous function to read a stream and instantiate the ROS message. On the ROS side, we have the TCP endpoint. This is all the code that is required for the TCP endpoint. This code snippet is actually taken directly from our tutorials. So the thing to point out here is the source destination dictionary that receives a key from every message sent from Unity and uses that to determine which publisher or service to call on the ROS side. Likewise, this key is used to determine which subscriber to pass messages along to in Unity from ROS. Finally, here we have a demo scene that highlights several aspects of what the teams here have been working on. There's quite a bit going on in this demo, so let's go one by one. First, there is a UR3 in the center of the table performing a pick-and-place task with a cube. The URDF was imported using our URDF importer, and what this importer does is it imports the visual and collision meshes of a robot, while also creating a game object hierarchy of joints and links, where joints have articulation bodies attached to them with things like rotational and velocity constraints applied from the URDF. So this is how we get a physics-accurate robot into a Unity scene. The scene is also fully integrated with ROS. To perform this pick-and-place task, the position and rotation of the cube, the current configuration of the robot's joints, and a desired placement position is sent to a ROS service, which is integrated with Move-It Trajectory Planner. The service then uses those three pieces of data to plan a trajectory that dictates how the robotic arm must move to to first pick up the cube, and then how it must move with the cube in its gripper to place it at the target destination. This trajectory is then returned by the service and executed on the robot. So historically, simulating this task would have been extremely difficult, but this has been made immensely simpler because Unity's ability to have a physics-accurate robot imported from URDF, a physics-accurate environment, an integrated trajectory planner with robot controlling code. In conclusion, simulation is a very important step for robotics development, and Unity has become an even more powerful tool for robotic simulation. Feel free to try it yourself. We have four links here. The topmost one is our robotics splash page. Below that, we have the Unity Robotics Hub GitHub repo, which contains tutorials and links to our other related repos. It even includes a pick and place tutorial like the one we showed earlier. Below that, we have the TCP endpoint repo, which is the server code executed in ROS that allows message passing between Unity and ROS. And finally, we have the TCP connector repo, which allows for easy communication with the TCP endpoint from Unity. This repo also includes the message generation plugin for generating C# classes from ROS messages. We also have some related resources. The top link is a blog post describing the physics improvement that make robotic simulation more accurate, and we have two related products as well. So Unity Simulation, which is a service for running simulations in the cloud at scale, and the Perception SDK, which helps generate synthetic data for training ML models like the cube position and rotation estimator demonstrated earlier. And finally, thank you very much for watching and enjoy the rest of Unite.